real quick. Don't have a lot of it. Well, hardly much for announcements tonight. Fry Bread Ministries is still Thursday night, July 7th. Please come and join us for that. And if you're available to help, please come down and help serve. So they do serve fry bread. We cook that up here. And I think we're having hangover soup. What's a hangover? No, please come and join us for that. Pastor Bruce Plummer usually has a pretty groovy message to go along with dinner, and an amazing heart to touch the First Nations. So please come help, please come join, and come and worship with us on Thursday night. So we still have Tuesday night's men and women's this week. So after the July 4th Monday, we'll still be doing the Tuesday night thing here. We're not engaged in a program, but we're going to get together and we're going to roll some scripture through and share life. How about that? Then eventually, once we can commit and get rolling and know that we can nail 4 weeks together, then we'll start that new end of me. And I'm not sure when Lumps will start that. It'll be at least 2 weeks after the men start it, but we'll figure it out. Or she'll figure it out. We'll leave that up to her. So, hey, Brian, you got that video real quick? Pastor JT's at Flathead Lake with the family.
Happy 4th of July. Hope everyone's safe. We want to wish you all a happy 4th of July. Hope everyone's safe. I know you guys got a great word from Cowboy last week, and I'm sure Marshall's going to knock it out of the park tonight. So we're having a great time up here. All the kids, all the grandkids, doing a little skiing, relaxing, getting some great quiet time with God. So you guys all be blessed. We will see you next Saturday. So be blessed and stay fired for Jesus.
Stay fired for Jesus. And I'm going to read he sent me this email. It was a forwarded email. I'm not sure who this person is. It says the subject on it is the power of prayer. It says, last Tuesday, I was walking in Gibson Park with my 8-year-old great-nephew, and a group from your organization stopped to talk to me. They asked if I had anyone that I would like to them to pray for. I told them about my Aunt Sharon, who was in the hospital and was so ill that the doctors thought she might not make it. We prayed in the park that day, and 2 days later, I was able to visit her because she was so much better. I really believe in the power of prayer, but I had not experienced such a quick response before. I wanted to tell you thank you and how it made such a big difference in my life to see my aunt on the mend. I am back in California now, but will never forget your group or my experience. Amen. So that's being that irresistible difference. We engage, we share life, we minister, we disciple. And we just let the Holy Spirit roll and do His job. Isn't that groovy? So, amen. Yeah, I'm not sure who that was or what that's all about, but you can't beat that. Very cool. So if you join me in our set free pledge. You have to stay at home, Lumpers. All right, please join me. I am part of the fellowship of the unashamed. I have Holy Spirit power. The die has been cast. I've stepped over the line. The decision has been made. I'm a disciple of Jesus. I won't look back or let up, slow down, back away, or be still. My past is redeemed, my present makes sense, my future is secure. I'm finished and done with low living, sidewalking, cheap giving, and dwarf goals. I no longer need preeminence, prosperity, position, promotion, or popularity. I don't have to be right, recognized, praised, regarded, or recorded. I live by faith, walk by patience. My face is set, my gate is fast, my goal is heaven, my road is narrow, my way is rough, my companions are few. My mission is reliable, my mission is clear. I cannot be bought, compromised, deterred, hired away, turned back, deluded, or delayed. I will not flinch in the face of sacrifice or hesitate in the presence of the enemy. I will not give up, shut up, let up until I've stayed up, prayed up. I will give till I drop, preach to all I know, and work till he stops me. And when he comes, my banner will be clear. Amen. So before we bring in tonight's offering, I'm just going to share this. I was talking to Tommy tonight. We're talking about the mission kids that were here. I had some Catholic mission kids that came in and helped serve. And we're just blown away by what they saw and witnessed, not only in these guys as they served others, but just the chance to serve and love on people. And how much they were just overwhelmed and just enjoyed that so much. And it kind of goes along with what we got to share last week on as far as where Jesus meets us, where he meets us at that point. And I was actually sharing this with James on Sunday. He was texting me and was asking me what the sermon was about. And it just hit me really funny because I said we were talking about where Jesus meets us at the cross. And I had to pause and I was like, wow, Jesus meets us at the cross road. That's where he meets us. I wish I would have had a big giant cross and intersection up there when I did this sermon. So, but that's where he meets us, and that's where you find him. And as I was sharing with Tommy tonight, it's in knowing what these kids were seeing and what they try to roll with, and what most of us actually try to roll with, even before we even walk in here. We're trying to go for that perfection. We're trying to fix something. We're trying to get all cleaned up before we come to the Lord, before we come to that cross. But he's going to meet you where you're at. And that's his love. And we're so busy trying to change ourselves, and we all have things. Anybody in here have anything they need to change? We could roll with that one all night. But the groovy part is he loves you right now. He will meet you at that crossroad, and that's he loves you. Even though I have things I need to change in my life, and if I get through that and make that change, he loves me just the same at the end of that as he does right now. Amen? So if you'd pray with me, we're going to bring in tonight's offering. Father God, Lord, truly thank you for this evening. We thank you for just the chance to serve and love and be a mighty witness, an irresistible difference for you. Father God, this evening as we bring in tonight's offering, may our hearts be open to your word. May our hearts just be open to you. Father God, we're ready to meet you at that crossroad. We're ready to serve, we're ready to give, and we're ready to be loved on by you. So Father God, we want to give you all the praise, honor, and glory this evening. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.
a cappella, but join us, okay?
Just open up in prayer, Father God. Oh, thank you. Father, we just thank you so much for your presence. We thank you so much for your glory, your holiness. We thank you for sending your son, Jesus. We give you all the praise. We magnify your name. We worship you with everything that we have, everything that we are, our minds, our spirits, our soul. Every pore of our body, Father God, we want to give to you. Father, we want to release everything to you. We want to step into faith that we've never seen before. We want to step out on you, even though the fear strikes us back. We want to step out so boldly in you, knowing that we can trust in you with everything. Father God, we just want to magnify you and give you all that we are, everything that we are, every portion of our life, our worries, our hurts, our pains, our sorrows, our finances, our workplace, our marriage, all the bondages that have been holding on to us, we want to release them to you. Father, right now we just want you to open us up. Take every single core of our hearts. Take every single file that we have filed away in our memory that has been convicting us over and over and over again, that has been guilting us over and over, that has been dangling in front of us like a carrot. Father God, you sent your Son to wash it all away. To wash it all away. To wash it all away. Father, those things that we have been hiding, those things that we have been holding on to, those things that the devil keeps on putting back on our shoulders, guilting us, ridiculing us, laughing in our faces, joking at us, keeping us back from kneeling down and praising you, keeping us back from worshiping you, keeping us back from receiving the promises in you, keeping us back because of our fear, because of our guilty conscience. No more. You say no more. Because you have forgiven us. You have forgiven us 100-fold. Everything has been covered. Everything has been washed away. There is a new freedom in the body of Christ that is about ready to emerge. That is the true freedom of sinlessness, of that consciousness of sin that keeps residing in us, that we think we have to do something. We think we have to make it happen. We think there is something that we are failing at. But Father God, you covered that too. Father, you are ministering to some hearts right now. There has been burdens and things that have been carried for many, many years. Whether it be a bitterness of a family member, whether it be a hatred towards your neighbor or a friend, whether it be an offense that you have taken long ago, maybe just yesterday. Maybe there is a prayer that has been unanswered and we have just written you off as saying no. Father, right now, we open ourselves up to you and ask you once again to come in. Release us from that guilt. Release us from that guilt. Yes, we have all sinned. But you have cleansed us. Yes, we may stumble and fall. But you pick us up again. As we can wipe ourselves off clean. Praise you, Father. Thank you, Father, for this moment, this second, right now. You are freeing the hearts. You are freeing our hearts right now of that bitterness. You are freeing our hearts of that pain that we have carried so long. You have freed our minds right now from thinking back in time about what we have done wrong. You don't care anymore because you have already washed us. We have already been forgiven. And you remember our sin no more. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Receive it. Receive it right now. Hallelujah. You can be seated. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen? Amen to that, huh? Thank you, Father. If any of you are here, the Lord gave me a word on at prayer on Monday, and that kind of hit the head of the nail. He is awakening his church not only to a revival, but he is awakening our hearts to really get back to the reconciliation that he really sent his son for. He redeemed us, cleansed us. It's not what we can do. You know, the Israelites wandered for how many years? 40. Moses was trying to get his people to the promised land for how long? Many, many years, generations. You know, back in the Old Testament, God had laws that they were not following. He promised it to them. They had right. They had their own right to the promises. But they failed to receive them because they were not obedient to his word or his instruction. God's instruction when he sent his son Jesus is for any of his children to reach out and receive Jesus as our Lord, and to reach out and receive all the forgiveness that comes with it, all the redemption that comes with it. But you have to receive it by faith, because we can't work our way to it. Unfortunately, the first father, Adam, made it impossible because we have sinned. From that standpoint, we are all sinners because of Adam. So really, we had to do the works back then. We had to sacrifice, but no more. So God right now, I believe, is calling his church back to the right standing of where we are in Christ. The right standing of believing who we are in Jesus. Now in kids' church, we start off by this. Everybody who has a Bible, put your Bible on your head. So you look ridiculous. And then we pass around a candy bucket for those who remember to bring their Bible. Now you can cheat because I know there's Bibles in the pews. But we don't cheat by putting scripture up in the children's church. We just actually group around, and we have all those who have Bibles, we just huddle in groups. But I won't make you do that, because I believe most of us have the Bibles. So I'm going to start in Romans chapter 6. And whether or not we get through these scriptures or not, that's up to the Holy Spirit. That's up to God. We're going to start in verse 12. Let not sin, therefore, reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey it in the lusts thereof. Neither yield your members or instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourself unto God and those that are alive from the dead. Verse 14, for sin shall not have dominion over Jesus. Sin shall not have dominion over us. We can stop right there, go home. Sin does not have dominion over us. Sin does not have a stronghold over us. When we took that step into receiving Jesus and all the redemptive power that comes with it, he cleansed us. He gave us the authority over the sin. So if that's possible, why do we keep sinning? There's a battle there. There's a battle that still has to be fought. There's a battle that has already been won, right? If we have received Jesus as our Lord and Savior, if we have been born again, here, turn to 2 Corinthians. Verse 17. I won't go too many scripture. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, sorry. No, all of it. We'll just read it all, huh? 2 Corinthians, the whole. Ready, begin. 2 Corinthians 17, 5:17 says, "Therefore, if any man, woman, child, any one of us in here, be in Christ, he is a new creature. Old things are what?
Gone.
Old things are what?
Gone.
Behold, all things are new." Well, wait, there's a key there. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. All things are of God who hath reconciled us himself by Christ Jesus, and has also given us the ministry of reconciliation. Any man, if any man be in Christ, raise your hand if you're in Christ, if you have received Jesus in here today. If you're here today, who has received? I guess we're all Christians. So any one of us, we have been reconciled from that sin nature. Now we're talking about a spiritual level because our spirits have been reborn. Supernaturally, God has transformed us and given us a rebirth inside of our spirits. Amen? Hallelujah? Not going to be all flowers, though, from here, because the battle still is within our flesh. One more. Ephesians 6:12. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Ephesians 6:12, "For we wrestle not against flesh and blood." But yes, I am. Why am I wrestling against this flesh and blood? We actually are wrestling against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against the spiritual wickedness in high places. It is the power of God's resurrection within our spirits that resides inside of us. So when we abide in Christ, we are now connected to that power of anointing that Christ is. And Christ is the perfect one, sinless, blameless. God does not recognize our sins because he sees us spiritually. He sees us in our reborn, re-robed spirit. The perfect whiteness in our spirit. So when we trip and fall, when we can't get control of this flesh, something has happened along the way where we failed to abide in Christ. Somewhere along the line, we have failed to get in unity in Christ, because Christ within us is the power that enables us to control the flesh. So, not to call us all holier than thou, but we as a church who have committed themselves to Christ, who has made him our Lord and Savior, who is continually on that path, now still has a choice to make to abide in him continually, moment to moment, day by day. Because the things that are going to come against us in this world are going to be your mother, your father, your friends, the workplace, people driving by on the streets. Things are going to happen in your body that's not going to agree with the word of God. The sicknesses, the oppression, the depression. The devil is going to bring back every single file that you have in your olden age, in your flesh, and put it and dangle it in front of you, in your face, and make you feel guilty, make you feel like a failure, make you feel like you are no one at all for God. Can we blame those around us for the circumstances that we're in? We're not supposed to, are we? You know what? Yeah, man, you should. My uncle, my great-great-great-uncle, man, he's got this, you know, it's just in the blood. It's just in my generation. We've always been that way. There's always been oppression. There's always been depression. Well, maybe so, but I think, wait a second, you just committed to Christ. Wait a second, he renewed you. You're new now, right? Well, let's stop that. It stops now with us in this generation. So when things come against you in church, oh, I'm speaking to church right here. When there are offenses that come against you from family members, from people out on the street, from your best friend, from your mother, sister, even your children, we do not have the right to step out in that abiding of Christ and get into our flesh again and sin and judge and ridicule and bicker and fight. Amen? That it leads to trouble. How dare we judge those who are trying to judge us because we don't have the right to? Because if we're completed, if we're actually been abiding in Christ, abiding in all of his promises that he has proclaimed in us, the forgiveness, the power to lay hands on people, the power to raise the dead, power to heal the sick, the power to pray for people, the power of all the gifts of the Spirit, the sword of the Spirit, all of your faith, all of your righteousness, all of the peace, all of the patience, all of that comes in that package when we're abiding in him. So if someone is not abiding in them themselves, it's not us to judge. Everybody is at their own level of faith. But we're all, as far as the church is concerned, we're all Christians. So I see so much. I mean, yeah, we'd expect it from the world. We expect that junk in the world to come against us. Oh, because they don't know Christ. Really? How about the church against the church? How about brother against brother? Sister against sister? Right? So, if I'm to look at my brothers and sisters, and if I get offended in some way, somehow, I better step back under that anointing of God. I better stand up, stand back, and get myself back into the Word. And remember that I am not wrestling against flesh and blood. I am not wrestling against that person who has now stepped out of themselves into their flesh and already started this sin pattern of ridicule, of you name it. And I wouldn't expect anybody to do the same to me. I would hope not. Yes, we're going to trip and fall. But I have found in my 16 years of ministry walking with God and understanding that when I abide in him, I am standing in that authority that he has given me in the Word. That if I take it literally when someone attacks me on the outside, I'm doing no good. But when I remember that it's not the flesh and blood, but the supernatural powers and principles of darkness that have eluded them to come against me, or vice versa, that have eluded against me to attack someone else, I better get on my knees. I better bite my tongue before I start slashing at someone behind their back. Starting a gossip that I have no right to start. Because I don't know where that brother or sister is. I don't know where they've been. I don't know what they've been through. Maybe, hallelujah, that if I am in unity and in that awe of God's power, that maybe He'll give me a discernment for that. Maybe He'll give me that wisdom of saying, Father God, you just showed me something of them, man. His grandma just died. Or he just got diagnosed with cancer. That's why he's so angry and bitter. And maybe he doesn't even know you. So either I can take offense to whatever his anger is at me, or just feeling that, right? Has anybody just felt an oppression on someone before? Or maybe get back into the prayer closet, get back on your knees. Abide once again and not judge anybody, because what you're wrestling against is the principalities and powers that are against them. So when you pray properly, you are praying against the enemy in their lives. You are praying against that oppression. You are praying against that fear. You are praying against that doubt. You are praying against that sickness. You're not praying against them, oh God, fix them. What the heck's their problem? They call themselves a sinner or a Christian. How hypocritical has the church become? We expect it from the world, but how hypocritical has the church become when we can't even face our own difficulties. We can't even face our own building up in our faith, building up in that word in ourselves. Because if we continually abide, I'll tell you what, your tongue stops. A lot of it does. We're just so anxious to get someone else coming into our own crowd and say, oh, so this, look at that man, they're Christian. Yeah, they go to that church over there, so and so. They say they roll in the Holy Spirit, and they're like, how hypocritical of them. Well, there you go. You just fell in the devil's trap, so are you. If we get our focus off of the flesh and really understand that we are a supernatural church, we are a supernatural body. If we walk in that spirit, moment to moment, the Lord will guide you and protect you from your own flesh. And I think God would take pleasure in you prospering yourself more than trying to tell someone else how to prosper in a ridiculing manner. Or, you know what? Some people aren't even ready to hear the truth. That in itself takes a discernment like none other. Yes, we can see on the outside they probably don't have Jesus. Yes, we can see on the outside that they're suffering this way. Boy, I'm going to dig this out. What scripture was that? Man, look at you. I got a word for you. Well, there you go. You know, we can do it in a subtle way. But when we abide in Him, the love of Christ will be within our hearts, and we'll go up to Him in a different manner. Maybe the Lord will just say, not yet. Maybe the Lord will just shut you down and say, no, I have another time for that person. Now let me show something I still need to work on in you. Cowboy said something earlier today. You know, the walk of faith is a works. But we don't gain access to heaven, obviously, by our works, because the Lord Jesus already covered all of that. The walk of faith is receiving by faith every single thing that God has for us. And I'll tell you what, there are many promises. Sorry. There are many promises that Christians go out through life and not yet obtain. Because maybe they weren't abiding and really willing to hear the voice, or really willing to hear the call that He has for them. You know, it takes a lot for someone to put down their life of knowing only one thing, and that's fishing. To follow someone who comes up at you and says, "Follow me, I'm going to make you fishers of men." To actually lay down your livelihood, everything that you know to do to provide for your family, leaving your home, takes a lot. That takes the step of faith. And the prayer we prayed earlier today about us completely opening ourselves up to Him, completely wanting Him to really peel back those layers of onions, layer after layer after layer, because we know that there's things deep down inside that we haven't let go. But that's the complete redemptive power that God wants to do for you. He wants you to unleash everything to Him. He wants to be the God of your household, the God of your marriage, the God of your work, the God of your finances, the God of everything that He has given possession to you for, the God of your fatherhood, motherhood. He wants every single aspect of your life. Let me take it a step further. We can release things to Him, but please remember to be open enough. And this is the challenge that so many Christians and in their walk of faith stop at. They release it and they walk away. God, help me with this. Jesus, remove this. God, I need money to pay for this bill. God, you know what? I kind of got your word. Why don't you send me $1 million so I can start being more of a servant? And you know, God is sitting there with these prayers in His hands. So, where are you going now? What are you doing? How are you supposed to receive it when you're walking away? When we want to receive the fullness of God, we have to expect that He's going to send. Number one, most of his answers are yes and amen, I'll tell you that. If they're in the Word of God, if they're a promise from God, if you're abiding in Him, you're not going to pray for something ridiculous. But I'll tell you what, He's going to want you to stand still, continue abiding in Him, and continue to stay open to Him, because there are things that He's going to bring to pass to rip you away from everything you knew in your life to be true, everything you knew to do to provide, fishing. He's going to rip something out of your life that you are so comfortable with, and He's going to tell you, now you need to change this. You ask me for this. You ask me for this promise, and it is a promise in my Word. Let me show you how to get there. I can't just throw it on you because you're not ready. But I'll tell you what, you stay in me and I will make you ready. You stay in me and I will show you the path to take. It may be a straight and narrow one, and you might not think it's really, really cool right now. It looks very scary. It looks like a hard road to follow, but it's a lot better than staying right here where you're at, because the world is at your beck and call. That hit someone? No one wants to be corrected. No one wants to be ridiculed. No one wants to be ashamed of anything. But God is not telling you to be ashamed. He's not going to throw anything in your face. But what He will do is say, I want you to take care of this that you have been holding on to. Release it to me. Now you want some of my blessings you have asked me for. Let me show you what's going on here. I want you to remove yourself from a situation, because if you don't remove yourself from what you're doing now, what's that called if you do something over and over and over again and expect a different result? Insanity. And I think the Word says that we all have the mind of Christ, right? Or do we? Right? I might be crazy standing up in front of you, but... So He gives us the mind of Christ to discern, to actually sit, okay, God, wow, you expect me to get there from here and do that? or give up this? Yeah. That's the hardest walk right there. That is the hardest walk. But I'll tell you what, the more you walk that narrow path, the more you continually abiding, it gets easier and easier. And the devil does not have that many tactics, I tell you what. The devil does not have that much on you. And as far as that's concerned, I'll take it any further. The devil doesn't have anything on you in the name of Jesus. He may come against you with all the lies and the deception, all your past woes. But I'll tell you what, when you stepped in that cross, when you stepped in accepting Jesus Christ, you have been cleaned. You are a supernatural being. God has instilled His supernatural rebirth inside of you. Each one of us are walking with the power of God in us and the power of Christ in us. And then He not only does that, then He gives us His word to use as a sword upon every circumstance and situation in our life. But I'm going to go back once again, because we have to remember who we're wrestling against. Please remember that. Because I'll tell you what, we blame so many people, so many circumstances, so many generations. We blame so many things around us for the circumstances that we're in. We have partaken, maybe we have partaken, maybe there are things that are out of our control. But I'll tell you what, when you stop blaming it and start realizing that the sin that is going on in this world is supernatural. This is the devil's world. We are just in it. But not only that, Christ is in us. And we have conquered that already. We already have that right standing with God. So we can take God's word and we can throw it in the devil's face. And we can stand on it with authority. But let's be careful how we use it against one another. Because God would rather see you prosper where you're sitting, where you are in your life, in order to recognize and discern and to grow your faith before you try to start growing someone else's faith when they may not be ready. I'm not stepping on the street ministry here. I mean, don't get to the, I mean, you guys go out and pray in the streets with the power of God, and we receive a testimony like that. Amen. There will be works that God asks you to do that you're going to be uncomfortable with. There will be things in your path. Say, well, you can still choose the life, or you can choose the death. You're still either with me or against me. So unfortunately, as a Christian, we do have a great responsibility. But I'll tell you what, that responsibility is so awesome that He gives us. And I cry out to Him, and I personally want to continue having me grow, having Him grow inside of me. I want Him to peel back every single layer so I don't have to be guilty for anything. And we are. We are cleansed of that guilt, but it seems like it comes back and backstabs us every single time. It backstabs us in fear. It backstabs us thinking that we're not good enough. Yes, you are. Because it's Christ in you. Amen. I went over time, didn't I? Sorry. Well, let's bow our heads. We have communion to take. If everybody wants to pass out, whoever wants to pass out communion with me. Father God, I think I saw everybody's hands up here, that they raise their hands in receiving you. But Father God, if there is someone in here right now that has not received you as Lord and Savior, that has not asked you to be their Lord and obtain all of the promises that you have, just raise your hand right now if you have not received Jesus as your Lord. Because He is the only way. He is the only truth. There is no other way. You can either walk in the world, you can continue walking in your sin. He's the only way to wash that sin away, to get into heaven. Father God, we're just so grateful for your mighty power that has redeemed us. We are so grateful for allowing us to be a part of your ministry and a part of your works. And Father, there are things right now in our lives that we want to lift up to you. But most importantly, we want to be able to be willing and open for the change that is taking place in our life. And we want to receive it by faith. Because you are an almighty loving God. You love us so much, Father God. And Father, we just want to pray over this communion right now. And Father, we're just so grateful for sending your Son to die on the cross to redeem us all. That blood that was shed, that body that was beaten and broken, every lash he took, he counted every single one and covered all of our sin. So Father, as we partake in this communion, let's remember the greatness, the awesomeness, the awesome power of your love and what Jesus did for us. How he redeemed us, how he washed away all of our sin, how he gave us the access to heaven, how he enabled us and rebirthed inside of us a new spirit that can come boldly into your heaven, into your throne room. And to call upon you at any time. And how you have given each believer the authority over the devil. And Father, we just praise you and thank you. We just give you all the glory and praise in Jesus' name. Amen. And I believe I printed out enough. How many did we have in here today, Mike? You want to pass them out? Now, these are just a print off on the internet. You can get them anywhere. But I have passed these out in our Wednesday night group. And I have passed these out to some people that I work with as well. Now, the power of God's Word is just transforming. And I ask that you guys, whoever, just take them. Put them on your bedside. These are some confessions that were in the Charles Capps book. And just simple scriptures of reminding us who we are in Him. The promises that He has given us in our spirits and in this life to accept and receive. And it's amazing what happens when your spirit connects to God's Word. There's a transformation that happens. So please, put those on your bedside if you need more copies. I can bring some more. I'll leave them in the back. I've got a copy at my workplace at work, and I'll just click on it, and I'll read through them, and it takes 5-10 minutes. And it's just feeding your spirit. Because if you're not feeding your spirit, you're kind of feeding your flesh. So I'd rather feed my spirit. I don't come down here for communion a lot, but I guess if anybody wants to come and partake, you walk up, or do you guys hand it out? Okay. Whoever's ready to receive communion, be blessed. That's your invite. And if anyone else said, let the church rise up fervently, without blemish, without blame, without fear. He said, rise up and be my children. Be my children of boldness. Be my children of walking in my blessings. Be my children who is going to carry out my work into the world. Be my children and know that I am God. Know that I am the I Am. Know that I am the El Shaddai. Abide in my Son. And he will abide in you. Let all of the power of the anointing of the rebirth inside of your spirit grow. And let it grow so strong in the truth of my word that nothing that is surrounding you, Nothing that is coming against you, nothing that is said against you will prosper, for you know who you are in Christ. You are my redeemed children. You are my calling. You are my gift. And you have entered into my into my promise, because you have received me and you have received my Son. So now go forth, go boldly. Do not turn back, for everything is old. Everything has passed away in your old self. Don't battle anything else around you. For if it's a battle around you, then it's a battle within yourself. So overcome your flesh, and you will find that my power within you is what is moving the mountains and what is raising the dead, what is going and preaching the gospel around the world. The power within me is in you. Don't doubt it, and don't let the devil make you think any differently. Freedom. Amen. Hallelujah. God is so good. Hallelujah.